In the 10 years since we first met her, Kelley Brewer has gone a long way. Then an aspiring singer. Today, her band, Human Wine, has a following from Boston to L.A. and into cyberspace. Their music is an eclectic mix, but the common theme is social justice.
Light drag me here.
I've always known I was an activist. There's always been revolutionaries, and I've always, at least since I was 10, knew that I fell into the category of people who really go with their gut and question everything and know when something's fishy and act on it.
And today, there's little doubt where that activism began.
Thank you so much.
Because Kelley Brewer told the Fifth Estate a harrowing story, one that pitted a young girl against her Jehovah's Witness religion, its powerful governing body in New York, the Watchtower Society, and a faith that believes when the world ends, sooner than later, they will be the ones chosen to survive. We first spoke a decade ago, growing up in a Jehovah's Witness family in New Hampshire, in the time before her tattoos and piercings. Every Sunday, she put on her best dress, a little girl who knew two things, the Bible and how to keep quiet. Because for years, beginning at the age of 3, Kelley was sexually abused by her stepfather, a respected member of their church. Her pain, eventually, would become her music.
Jehovah's Witnesses, we were taught to be loyal, do our dances. All the elders.
He took away my entire childhood. He absolutely took it away. And I was a very little person. And I learned how to be a big person immediately.
By 5, she says, she knew how to please her stepfather sexually. Paul Berry threatened that if she didn't keep their secret, she wouldn't survive Armageddon, the end of the world that's at the very heart of the Jehovah's Witness faith. So there was no safe place for Kelley when Paul Berry took her into the barn or to their secret room beneath the house.
I put down some sheets. They made it look nice and made it suitable for rape. He always called me a bitch, a little bitch. He was a very kinky person. You memorize these motions of, he's gonna hold me there, then I'm gonna do this to him, and then I'll be on top. He'd say things like, you're better than your mother. But it always ends with pain when you're little because you're too little. Your spaces are too little for their spaces.
Kelley's mother, Sarah, also physically abused by her husband, eventually went to church elders for help, which is what Jehovah's Witnesses are told to do. Elders are supposed to be their spiritual shepherds, but hers did nothing.
Their response was that I needed to pray more and be a better wife. That was their response.
When we first did this story, that was the recurring theme. That in many cases of alleged sex abuse, Jehovah's Witness elders blamed the victims. Though in theory, child welfare and law enforcement were mentioned, in practice, they were rarely called in. Elders tried to keep it all within the church. In fact, church critics were told of a secret registry at the headquarters in New York with the names of more than 20,000 Jehovah's Witness sex offenders. And official policy was that in the case of an alleged sexual assault, if there were no witnesses, and no confession, the investigation was closed.
Delta 1 King will be in the downtown area.
In fact, the abuse of Kelley Brewer only stopped because she finally had the courage to tell local police detective Jack Zeller.
To watch a child relive a rape, relive a torture, relive the horrors that she must have had to sleep with. She shivered and she cried when she talked to me, and you just knew she was feeling it all over again.
What did you call this room?
The secret room.
Police accompanied then 16-year-old Kelley back to the house in New Hampshire to document what happened. Paul Berry was arrested for what he had done.
Thank you. I was really little.
You were really little, I know.
Though the Jehovah's Witnesses supported her stepfather in court, He was sentenced to a minimum of 56 years in prison, which likely means he'll die behind bars.
They have a phrase, you don't want to ruffle the feathers of the flock. They literally say that.
In the years since, Holly and her family became symbols of rebellion for those who've remained in the Jehovah's Witness faith. For many, that's not a good thing.
Some of the people who had stayed in the truth, as they call it, had told me that they passed around pictures of my mother and my sister and me at almost all the congregations in the District of New England, warning people that we had been seduced by the devil.
But since we first met, it's clear she's resolved not to allow the past, as terrible as it was, to define her.
When you're laying on the ground and you're forced, either you're forced on the ground or you've put yourself there because you think you don't deserve any better, everyone looks like a big, evil, mean oppressor. If you stand up, you're like, oh, you're like my height. You're not even a big problem at all. Okay, I can handle this. I can call you out.
Country road, take me home to the place. I belong, West Virginia, mountain mama.
And by standing up, it seems life has become so much better these days for Holly and her husband and musical partner, Matt McNiss.
Palm trees, I'ma miss you. Because when you see a palm tree, that's how you know it's warm. We're not going where it's warm next.
With performances from coast to coast, here about to leave California for New England, they're like 21st century refugees from the 60s. Living in a converted school bus, a log cabin on wheels, it runs on biodiesel, essentially vegetable grease.
Everything in here, all the wood that is in here already, is either dumpster dived just a score. So this is like phase one. I love it. I love the bus. Let's collect gas from restaurants, sleep in the van, eat from the van, solar panels, run the fridge, and just actually keep the capital that we create.
It's the world's tiniest, cutest, fully functioning propane-powered stove.
Of course, a movable home is ideal when you relocate about once every 3 months.
Okay, we're rolling.
Holly Brewer says after all that's happened in her life, the most important thing she's learned, maybe how to move on.
There is a time when it's time to turn the page. There's also a time when it's time to close the book. You don't have to throw away the book in a yard sale or barter it. You know where it is on the shelf. You can access any of those pages at any time. But now, the books don't just fly off the shelves. Those pages don't any longer present themselves at your face and say, deal with me, because you've put them in the order they belong in, you've dealt with them, you know where they are, and you've filed them.
Do you ever allow yourself to wonder how your life and how you might be different if none of this had happened?
Oh, I've thought about it.
What do you think?
Anything could have happened. I definitely think, personally, I became stronger because of every single thing that happened to me. I don't know if everyone would have had the same reaction. Yeah, I'm incorrigible. Yeah. Okay, so that whole thing was just terribly sad, and I have to do it one more time, I'm sorry. 10 years ago, I was a little less optimistic about what people were capable of, because my experience had been lots of people trying to steal my light. And I realized that I have an unending connection with everything that ever made me. And you can't steal someone's light. You can only borrow it.
Angels of light.
10 years after she told her story to us, twice that since she first took on her church, Holly Brewer still writes and sings about injustice, though now less about her own, and increasingly about how it can be overcome.
I've decided to be a superhero in a way, because it feels better to stay active. It feels better to stay positive. So I do have a lot of hope for humanity, and I have a lot of love for humanity. And I don't think everything's worthless, and I don't think there's no hope, and I don't think there's no chance. Woke up in the morning sun, sitting on my shoulders, one incredible thing. Love always wins. It always wins, and it feels way better than any other thing besides love.
And this time when we caught up with her, she'd written something she couldn't have 10 years ago. A love song.
And then it just keeps going.
You heard it here first.
You did, it's a first. That's awesome.